Here's the scripture for today, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 13 and 14. Paul says to the Corinthian church, he says, if there's no resurrection, then Jesus isn't alive. He's not living. There's no living Christ. He's dead. And let's face it, if there's no resurrection for Christ, everything we've told you and everything you've staked your life on is just a bunch of smoke and mirrors. Everything that we believe as Christians is hinges on this one event that took place in history. We've been celebrating it now for hundreds, now thousands of years, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If there is no resurrection, Paul is saying, then all this is meaningless. Like none of it makes sense. It's all worthless. He says in one translation that we're just to be pitied amongst all men if there's no resurrection. I don't know if you've ever read the book, The Case for Christ. There's a movie out now. Anyone go see that movie, The Case for Christ? Anyone? If you haven't seen that, do yourself a favor or read the book. If you're a reader, you don't like watching movies, The Case for Christ. It is a phenomenal book and movie. Lee Strobel, it's about his life. He wrote the book, and it's about the movie's about his life in that book. He was an atheist and a journalist, and his wife got saved, and he set out to prove the resurrection was false because he knew this whole faith hinges on the resurrection. So he set out using all his journalistic skills to get the facts, get the evidence, state the case, and prove it wrong, and win his wife back from that crazy cult is what he was thinking. But he went on this journey. It took him a while, and he investigated all the facts, and he gave his life to Jesus. And now he's a pastor. He's been a pastor for years now. Here's the truth about the resurrection, you guys. And this is, if you can seek it out for yourself if you're skeptical today. If you go search out the facts, what you're going to find out is that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is one of, if not the best historical account on record that we have of all ancient texts. Of all, not just the Bible. I'm talking about other historical records. It is that Jesus, there was a man named Jesus who claimed to be God, who lived when the Bible says he lived, who was crucified and reportedly rose from the dead and was seen by 500 people. Okay, that's so. And if you're here today and you are a skeptic and you're kind of like, I don't know about this stuff, I'm so glad you're here. Check it out. At the end of the message, I'm going to ask you a question. But for now, I'm going to ask you to kind of table the pushback, table kind of your answers that you have, and let's go on a journey together. Let me take you on a little journey for the next few minutes that we have together this Easter Sunday, and let's look at what God has to say about this. Here's what I do know, though. Maybe for a lot of us, you're not skeptics, a lot of you. I would venture to say most of you are believers, or that you do believe in God or believe in Jesus. There was a Barna research poll that said that 9 out of 10 people in the United States of America, actually it was 8.9 out of 10. I don't know how you get 0.9 people, but 8.9 people out of 10 in America believe in God. They believe in God. But here's what I do know, being a pastor for as many years as I have been a pastor, is that I think that a lot of times our life is the decisions we make, the choices we make, the thoughts we think, and the things we do are not marked by that belief. Maybe there's, for a lot of us, there's a want to believe. Like, I want to believe, but man, I'm a little confused right now. Or I'm a little hurt right now. Or I don't understand why this happened. I want to believe, like I know, but man, something just does not make sense to me. And the disciples were actually in this same conundrum that you and I find ourselves in very often, when it's hard to believe in life's difficulties and tragedies. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 31, Jesus told his disciples, he said, this very night, you're all going to fall away on account of me. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. They'll run. They'll start going in different directions. So these disciples, the shepherd, Jesus, was taken and beaten, and all the disciples go, wait a second, I didn't sign up for this. This isn't the way it's supposed to go. I thought, you know, believing in God or in Jesus was going to make my life better. Now it's, I mean, And so why are my finances the way it is? Why is my business failing the way it is? Why is my relationship suffering the way it's suffering? And why did my mom have to die? Why am I sick now, God? Like, I don't understand. When it's hard to believe, the hardest time it is for us to believe is when trials hit our door. In the middle of the difficulty, the problem, and the trial, that's where our faith begins to waver. That's where we scatter. We start to go in different directions. We start to doubt God, doubt our faith, maybe even stop even coming to church for a little bit because, if all of us were honest and brutally honest, we would say, you know what, there are times because of problems and trials that I don't believe. I want to, but I don't. I have some disbelief. And the reason is because just like the disciples, they were in between this moment, this Friday, Saturday. They were not at Sunday yet. They were in this moment where their Jesus, their Savior, was taken. And they were stuck between the promise or the pain and the promise. And a lot of you maybe feel like that today. You're stuck right there, like you're enduring some pain, you're in the trial, but you know there's a promise. Like, I know there's a resurrection, I'm just not experiencing that right now in my life. And when that happens, when you get stuck in that zone and your mind and your heart gets stuck there, you will begin to scatter, go in different directions, doubt your faith and doubt God. Here's what I'd like to do today is we need to have a better understanding of trials, because that's what's tripping a lot of us up. When the trials come, like, everything's okay until there's a trial, until there's an issue in life, then that's when faith is tested. That's when real faith comes alive, is when the trial is at your door. So we need to understand trials a little bit better. But what I want to tell you next is that there's resurrection power available to you. That you can endure and overcome every trial that the enemy or this world would ever throw at you. And the reason why oftentimes you as followers of Jesus do not endure or you waver and scatter in the time of the trial is because you're not positioned, you're not stationed in the place of resurrection. There's three things that resurrection power affords you, that if you were to apply these, living these, if you were to allow the resurrection power of Jesus Christ to be your filter of your past, your present, and your future, there is nothing this devil or world could ever do to you that would make you scatter or fall away. So I want to give you those three things in just a moment. But first, let me give you some understanding about trials. Let me give you four truths, okay? Three of them are a bummer. I'm just going to tell you straight up. They're true, but they're not fun. They're not fun truths about trials. But one of them, the last one is, it'll make you happy. Here, write these down. Some understanding about trials. This is when our faith begins to be tested and wavers. Number one is trials are inevitable. Trials are inevitable. If your goal in life is to make sure nothing bad ever happens to you, to make sure you just do, I'm telling you, you're setting yourself up for a huge fall. You are. You're setting yourself up for a huge fall. In fact, some of you even think that God has obligated himself to never allow bad things to happen to you. I mean, that's in his job description. He's God. So when something, when there is decaying and ugliness and the effect of this fallen world starts messing with your life and your family, you go, wait a second, God, that's why I got you in my life. Why is this happening? When the Bible never promised that would be the case. Jesus never said that you would never experience the trials of life anymore. Actually, he said the opposite in John 16, 33. Jesus says, I've told you these things so that in me you would have peace. But in this world, you will have, you're not going to find a lot of peace, is what he's saying. Like, Jesus is saying, in me you're going to have peace, but in this world, there's not a lot of it out there. In this world, you're going to have trouble. And no one's looking at that verse and going, that's my verse, baby. Put it on the fridge. Yeah. Amen. That's just, no one does it, but it doesn't make it any less true. It's true. It's still true. But take heart, Jesus says, I have overcome the world. You see, God never, his plan was not to take you out of the storm. His plan was always to give you a peace in the midst of the storm so that you would overcome, that it wouldn't overcome you. So trials are, they're inevitable. Here's the second thing we need to know about trials, and that is trials are unpredictable. Trials are unpredictable, meaning you can't really plan for them. Sometimes you're able to discern when some are coming, but many of them just spring up on you. They just come out of nowhere. Sometimes it feels like they come one right after the other, like on the heels of another trial. I felt like I was just getting over one thing, and here comes another thing. The prophet Jeremiah was talking about that when he said in chapter 4, verse 20, he says, disaster follows disaster, meaning one thing after another. God, the whole land lies in ruins. In an instant, my tents are destroyed and my shelter in a moment. It's like a constant battery, and you just need to know you can't predict them. And nor would you want to live your life in constant fear and protection of the trials. Trials are not only inevitable, they're unpredictable, but also, here's the next one, that is, trials are impartial. Trials are impartial. People ask this question, the famous question they always ask, why me? Why me? What did I do to deserve this? Let me ask you, why not you? Okay? Why not? You say, well, I didn't do anything. Why does this happen to me? Well, the Bible actually, the truth is, the Bible says in Matthew 5:45, Jesus says that God causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good. And he sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous, meaning, in other words, what you're going through is something all of us have to go through. It's not just you that have to go through the trial or go through pain. Every single one of us, and sometimes, let me just set the theology straight here, it's just human nature to connect bad circumstances to what did I do? Oh, I must have did something wrong, connected to something I did. They did it in Jesus' day. They would always try to, there was this blind man. You guys remember the story? There was a blind man. The disciples said, who sinned, Jesus? Was it his sin or was it his parents' sin? They didn't even give him another option. It must have been someone's sin. It's either him or his parents. And Jesus looks at him and says, your theology is messed up. You're way off. No one, none, either of them. This is just life. This is life. Okay? In fact, you know what he said? He said, this happened so that the Son of Man may be glorified. See, what you see as a setback is just a setup for God to be glorified in your life. That trial, that problem, and that pain that you're having to endure for a season, it's not supposed to overtake you. It's not supposed to crush you. It's not even supposed to be a setback. It's just a setup for God to be glorified in your life. See, trials are impartial to all of us. Here's the last thing. None of those are good, really. But this last one is, okay? And the fourth truth is that trials are temporary. They're temporary. And I know it doesn't feel like it in the middle of it, but they are. They're temporary. And what you're going through right now, I know it feels so long, I know it feels so hard, but I'm telling you that it's temporary. And we get to the point oftentimes where we want to give up, we want to turn our back on God, or maybe turn our back on the church. And I'm telling you, I know I was sent on assignment by God to encourage you today, to tell you, you don't have to be afraid anymore. I'm talking to somebody here. You don't have to be afraid anymore. You don't have to run anymore. You don't have to hide anymore. Like, you don't have to scatter any longer. Here's a verse for you. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35 through 37 says, so don't throw away your confidence. This ain't the time to do that. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, you need to persevere. Come on, turn to them. Tell them, you need to persevere. So that when you've done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, and it never looks like and feels like a little while, it's going to feel like a long while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. It goes on to say that my righteous ones will live by faith and they will not shrink back. They don't get to this place where they go, oh, I can't take it anymore. No, the Bible says that they press through it. I'm telling you, wherever you are in your business, your marriage, your emotions, that tragedy that seems like it's surrounding your life, whatever trial you face, listen, hang in there. You're going to overcome in Jesus' name. Well, how do you know that? How can you be so sure, Jason? Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's how I know. That's how I know. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19 and 20. Paul says, I also pray that you will understand. And that's my hope. I've been praying for you. I've been praying that God opens your understanding in this area of resurrection power, that it will change your life, that it will reposition your life to a place of resurrection power. Here it is. I pray that you will understand that incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe. This is the same power that raised Christ from the dead. You see, the resurrection of Jesus is not just some historical event that, you know, is accurate, and a lot of people have proven the. It's not just a day that we get to celebrate once a year, although we do. We celebrate it every week. We celebrate the risen Jesus. But it's more than that. You see, God didn't just intend for the resurrection to be celebrated. He intended for the resurrection to be experienced. You can experience resurrection power living inside of you. There is no death that the power of Jesus and the power of resurrection cannot redeem. No death. And I think there's so many people all across the nation and the world that are going to attend a church today, and they'll never experience the power that God has available to them. Are you hearing me, church? God has resurrection power available to you. There's a power, and he never intended us to just attend church once a week and sing a few songs and read a few scriptures and go eat ham and go home. You know, it was supposed to be so much more than that. He always intended for us to experience something that rocked our world, a power that was so life-changing and altering. And we've reduced this thing, Christianity and following God, sometimes down to this something so lifeless, traditional, meaningless, that it doesn't add or do anything for us. But I tell you, I think it's one of my life missions to help people experience the resurrection power of God. Now the resurrection power of God gives you three things. Now, if you were to reposition your life, if you were to receive these three things, stand in the resurrection power of Jesus Christ in your past, in your present, and in your future, nothing and no one can shake you from your faith. Nothing. You will no longer be scattered. You'll no longer be hot and cold, in and out of church, in and out of faith. You will go from glory to glory, from level to level, if you learn how to walk in the resurrection power that is available to you today. Here they are. Here's the first thing that the resurrection gives you. It's affordable to you today. Here it is, number one. And I wrote it down in like personalized statements. You can receive this today. Come on. Resurrection power. Because of that, my past can be forgiven. My past can be forgiven. There was this email another pastor received. He shared it with me. It was from a female in his church. She said, I'm 31 years old and divorced. Though I fought the divorce bitterly, I feel badly. I have no hope for my future. Often I go home and cry, but there's no one holding me when I cry. Nobody cares. Nothing changes, and I continue to fail. I'm stressed out emotionally, but I feel I'm on the verge of a collapse. Something is very wrong, but I feel so hurt and embittered that I can scarcely react or relate to others anymore. I feel as if I'm going to have to sit out the rest of my life in the penalty box. And the tragedy is there's so many people who feel the same way. They feel like their past sins and mistakes has marred them, stained them, and scarred them to the point where, oh, I guess this is the new me. I just got to live with this. I got to learn how to adapt to this and make it work, and you're carrying around the baggage of your past, and you're wondering why you can't be happy and you can't find happiness because you're carrying this weight around of your past. And Colossians chapter 2 verse 14 has the good news for you. If that's you today, listen to this. He, Jesus, has forgiven all our sins and canceled every record of debt that we owed. Christ has done away with it by nailing it to the cross. Jesus paid my guilt so I can stop paying for it myself. I can stop trying to feel guilty myself. Jesus was hung on the cross for my hangups. Jesus was nailed to the cross so you can stop nailing yourself to the cross. It says he canceled the debt. It's done. It's paid for. Let me ask you something. How long do you remember a bill after you paid it? Huh, never. That thing's gone, baby, right? That's how I am. Like, that thing's gone. Never. I think what he's trying to say is this. See, once he's forgiven it, you can forget it. That's what he's trying to say. Once he's forgiven it, you can forget it. Romans 8:1 says, there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ. Jesus did not come to rub it in. He came to rub it out. Come on, somebody. He said, I didn't come to condemn the world. I came to save it. He wants to change you. He wants to help you. He wants to give you a new beginning. Today, you can experience the resurrection power of Jesus Christ by receiving forgiveness from your past. That's the power that's available. Here's the second thing I want you to believe today, because the resurrection power, and that is, my problems can be managed. My problems can be managed. Not much of this life is unmanageable. It really isn't, especially if you're a parent. I was reading this week about Charlie Shedd, an author. He tells a story of himself. He said, before we had kids, his wife and him, he said, I used to travel across the country teaching a lecture I called The 10 Commandments for Raising Perfect Kids before I had kids. After him and his wife had their first child, he changed it to 10 Hints for Parents. After their second child, he relabeled the lecture A Few Tentative Suggestions for Fellow Strugglers. And then he said after the arrival of his third child, he gave up speaking on the topic altogether. I saw this poster a few weeks ago. It said, teenagers, and I have a teenager now, so this is just extremely funny to me. It says, teenagers, tired of being harassed by your dumb parents? Act now. Move out, get a job, pay your own bills, do it while you still know everything. Isn't that fun? That's funny. So listen, maturity is not where you got it all figured out. Maturity is when you figure out that you can't have it all figured out. That's what maturity is. Maturity is when you realize that you can't manage all that life is going to throw at you, but check it out, God can. God can. I can't control everything in my life, but God can. I talk to people all the time that say they say one variation of this or the other. They say something like, I feel like my life is out of control. I feel like I'm powerless to change this bad habit. I feel like I'm powerless to change my relationship. I feel like I'm powerless to get out of debt. I feel like I'm powerless to change this situation. You need a power greater than yourself. That's the problem. You need a power greater than yourself. You were never meant to live this life just on your own power. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20 says, how incredibly great is his power to help those who believe him. The same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead. That same power that enabled Jesus to rise from the dead is going to help you rise above every one of your problems. It is resurrection power that enables me to manage my current problems, whatever life is throwing at me. I don't know what the future holds. I don't know what later on today is going to happen, tomorrow, next week, next year, but that's okay because God does. God knows. And although I'm not in control, he is. Philippians chapter 4, 13 says, I am ready for anything through the power of positive thinking. No, that's not what it said, right? Some of you are like, amen. No. It didn't say that. I'm ready for anything because I psyched myself up. No. I'm ready for anything through the strength of Christ who lives in me. God's saying, I want to help you out. No matter how hopeless the situation is, some of you came crawling in here today. You have had a tough week. Maybe you've had a tough season. God wants to say to you, don't give up. No problem is too big for God. No situation is hopeless if you turn it over to him. Resurrection power gives you. You can have this resurrection power by receiving forgiveness of your past. The resurrection power allows you in your present to manage whatever circumstance, whatever trial that you're going through. Here's the next thing that is available to you because of the resurrection power. And if you position your life from this place, I'm telling you, you'll be unshakable. And that is number three, my future can be secure. My future can be secure. A lot of people don't like to think about their future, as in their future home in heaven and life after this life. Many people, even Christians, don't like to think about that, don't like to talk about that. It's an uncomfortable subject. And here's the problem with that. Look, because if you're not standing in the resurrection power of that understanding that your future is secure, and you just try to, I don't want to think about death, I don't want to think about afterlife, something's going to happen. The enemy is going to bring a trial to your life. It's going to force you to think about it, and you're going to grab hold of the wrong thought, and you're going to begin to scatter again. If you don't position yourself from, my future is secure because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, my future is secure. No matter what's happening, no matter if there's a storm out, no, I know my future is secure. So let's talk about that for just a moment. They asked some children to write down some sentences about what they believed about death. I love reading like children, like, because kids say the funniest things. So Gilda, age 8, said, when you die, they put you in a box and bury you in the ground because you don't look too good. Stephanie, age 9, said, doctors help you so you won't die until you pay their bill. So, Marsha, age 9, said, when you die, you don't have to do homework in heaven unless your teacher is there too. Raymond, age 10, said, a good doctor can help you so you won't die. A bad doctor sends you to heaven. That's funny. I don't care. Come on. The fact is that everyone has this internal longing, though, to kind of know, you know, what's going to happen. John 17 and 3 says, this is the way to have eternal life, by knowing the only true God in Jesus Christ, the one he sent to earth. There is no other name given among men whereby we shall be saved, but by the name of Jesus. Nothing else, not your good works can get you there, not comparing yourself to the other person that you're better than, or no, none of that works. Only Jesus can, only the resurrection power of Jesus can secure your future in heaven eternally. Now, it's one thing for me to come up here and tell you these things and give you these truths of hey, there's resurrection power for you, and man, if you just kind of position your life and know that your sins are forgiven and you live that way, you live with that freedom and you live with this understanding that I'm not going to handle it myself, but there's something in me greater. There's a resurrection power available that I can take whatever this world has, because Christ in me is greater than he's in the world. And man, my future is secure. It's one thing for me to teach that, but you're going to forget most of it by dinner. It's just what it is, okay? And it's the saddest thing for a preacher. It really is, but it's the truth. Or next week, a lot of you aren't going to remember that. But one thing that the human mind does remember is stories. We remember a story. It's able to kind of capture so much more than just a preaching or a lecture or a talking head can give. So we prepared a couple stories of what the resurrection power of Jesus Christ could do for you. Check it out.
I remember I made a decision. I wasn't going to talk to you, God, and I turned my back on him. I had my first stroke at 42. It took out the left side of my body. It was dead for a good year. I had to recuperate.
At a very young age, I knew I was attracted to females. All through my younger years, when I went to church, I was always treated bad, like, because I had the look of being gay. So when they saw me, they treated me. They didn't talk to me. They wouldn't look at me. And if they did, they gave me that look like, oh, yeah, she's a sinner.
I had another stroke, and it was on the other side of my brain this time. It was just a little shaker, but the doctor still wouldn't tell me any different. God still wasn't speaking to me. I remember I made a decision. I wasn't going to talk to you, God. And I turned my back on him. I started to drink. 25 years of sobriety. Right down the tubes.
So I was attending a church before Discovery, and a lot of people there were rude to me. And they would tell my partner, they would tell her, hi, good morning, God bless you. And they wouldn't look at me. Like, do they not see me standing here? Am I invisible? Can't they tell me hi, God bless you? That really hurt me. It made me not want to go to church.
And out of nowhere, I heard God's voice. And he said, wake up. I immediately cried out to say, I'm sorry. And I could only get I'm out of my mouth. And I heard him say, follow me. Today I live a life I can't even explain it. What God is doing in me, I only long that you too would be able to experience what I'm experiencing this moment. Every day that I wake up and I sit on my back porch, I watch the sun rise, and then I pray, and then I just praise my God. I just thank you, you know, I praise you, and then I ask, what is it that you have for me today? You're the one I want to serve.
So we decided we were going to try Discovery. You know, they shook her hand, shook my hand, gave her a hug, gave me a hug. And I was just like, wow, like they're acknowledging me. You know, they're really acknowledging me. So, but then I started to feel convicted. And I started to feel that God was pulling me away from my partner because of the hours that they gave me. And like, we weren't seeing each other hardly as much. When I was at work, she was at home. When she was at work, I was at home. And so I spoke to her and I told her, I said, you know, I believe that God's trying to pull us apart. I feel that. She was upset. She was crying. And she was like, you're right. God is separating us. As much as it hurts, he's separating us. You know, he has chosen us. And it hurt. But at the same time, it was like a great feeling to know that God wanted us. You know, to want someone like me. You know, because of my lifestyle, I didn't think that God would want me. That next week I had off and I moved everything out of her room. Everything that I owned, I removed it from her room. And I know God has her as my best friend now because she's been able to help me. I feel beautiful. Like I never felt as beautiful as I feel now. And when pastors tell me that I'm beautiful and all the women of the church, it makes me feel so good. Like every woman that I've come in contact with, every male at the church, they're just so loving and just make me feel so beautiful. And I just, and God makes me feel beautiful. You know, I pray to him and he always answers my prayers. And I, my life is just so different now. It's just great.
Come on, give God some praise right there. There is no pain that God's power cannot resurrect. No pain. I don't care where you've been or what you've done. You're never too far, and it's never too big. Not for God. Last 3 points in your handout says three options. You have three options of what to do with Jesus. Really, that's who is Jesus? There's only three answers to that. That's the only answers really that Jesus has given us the option for. Some people say, well, Jesus was a good teacher or he was a prophet or some of these things. You really can't say that. That's not on the table. I'll show you why. Number one, Jesus is either a liar. Number one, he either, because he claimed to be God, okay? And he either, and if he's not God, that makes him a liar, someone who's not worth following, not worth putting, sacrificing your life for. That's one option. The second option about Jesus is he's a lunatic. He's a crazy guy. I mean, he really thinks he is God. He's not lying. He thinks he's God, and he's not. And the third option is that he's Lord. He's either Lord, a liar, or a lunatic. And my question to you today is, who do you say Jesus is? Who is he? And at this point in the message, I usually would say, you know, bow your heads, close your eyes, and we would have a little time of prayer. We're going to do something a little bit different. Will you grab out this card? Everybody, if you will, go ahead and grab out this card. This is, if you're new with us today, just by turning this card, you get entered into a raffle to win 2 Disneyland tickets. Any visitors, this is what we're doing. 2 Disneyland tickets for these cards. So look, and we're not going to go knock on your door or mail you stuff. We'll probably send you 3 emails a year. That's what we do here. 3 emails all year is what you'll get. And then you can, if you don't want them, you can still say no to them, okay? But here, check it out. On the back of that, it says, everybody do that. Just grab it in your hand. You can even turn in, just humor me. Turn in a blank card. I don't care. Just put it in your hand and look at it. Act like you're doing something with it. It says A, B, C, or D. Okay, you are, and what your response is to Jesus today is one of those, A, B, C, or D. The A, some of you are the A category, and I think a lot of you would fall into that category. You would say, I've already put my trust on Jesus. I've done that. Man, I'm a believer. I've given him my life. I believe in Jesus. He is my Lord. If that's you, you just check off the A. That's you. A lot of you would probably fit into that category. Some of you would fit into the B category, which you're saying today, I'm beginning to do that today. I today am beginning to put my trust on Jesus. If that's you and you're ready to do that today, I mean, that's between you and God. You check off that box. If that's your decision today, I would love to know because I would love to pray for you. I'll shoot you an email that just kind of gives you some next steps in your faith walk with Christ. But put that right there. If you're beginning that today and you're ready to do that with Jesus, check that box. The C, some of you here would say, I'd like to consider it a little bit more, Jason. I mean, I'm still kind of seeking this thing out. And can I say, if that's you, please feel free. Take as long as you want to seek truth out. You are welcome here. If you are just seeking it out, don't really know, kind of unsure about this whole, you know, Jesus thing, but you're looking for truth, you can belong here at Discovery before you believe. You don't have to believe before you belong here. And we love you, accept you, embrace you. That isn't, you can belong here before you ever believe. Some of you would feel, if that's you, check that off. In the D category, there's always a few of you in every service that say, man, I don't ever intend to make that decision. You are crazy. You are a cult. You guys are just, everyone's crazy. I am not giving my life for anybody. You know what I mean? It's my life. You know, whatever it is, if that's you, if you're like, I don't ever really ever intend to make that decision. If that's you, just have the confidence. Have the kind of, you know, I want to say something else right there. Have the, what? The moxie. That's a good one because I was going to say something else that's not good. Have the moxie. Check off D. And here's what I'm going to do. You probably don't care for it or don't even like it, but I will pray for you. I'm going to be praying for you. And I'll even say, please, if that's you and you are a D, you are welcome here. You totally are. I would love, if there's something about the environment, the music, just kind of the relevant messages that kind of help you out in your life, amen. Come, hang out with us. Same is true for you. You can belong here. You can belong here, and you don't even have to believe. We would be honored if you came and took part in what we're doing. You're one of those. Okay, do me a favor. Fill out, just check off one of those, and then bow your heads and close your eyes and show me that you're ready and you're done.